Beginning of session 11 of webinar on literature from the margins. Welcome everyone and good afternoon. I'm Sudarshan Gupta and I and Sumita will be your coordinators for today. I would like my co-coordinator Sumita Dutta to introduce the chairpersons. Sumita.
Yes sir. Thank you very much Professor Sudarshan Gupta. A very warm welcome to everybody to this international webinar. During last few months, our world has been going through a very tough situation, and in this pandemic, our life has completely changed and also has a very serious impact on our daily life. But still, we are trying to connect our social activities through online. So now we are going to start our technical session number 11. Today, the English department of Rishi Bankim Chandra College and Rishi Bankim Chandra Evening College has jointly organized 2 days long international webinar on English literature from the margins of class, caste, race and gender. In this session, we have prepared presentations by faculty members, researchers, scholars and also independent researchers. So now I wish this interactive session will be very enchanting and as well as enriching. Now I would like to introduce our chairpersons. So Professor Tanvir Sarnawaz, Assistant Professor of Rishi Bankim Chandra College, Department of English, Naihati. His area of interest are Indian literature and culture. And Professor Ruksha Roy Choudhury, our faculty member of Rishi Bankim Chandra College, Department of English, Naihati. Her area of interest are disability studies, Victorian literature, culture and gender studies. It's a great honor to introduce you, sir, and ma'am. I would like to ask Professor Tanvir Sarnawaz and Professor Ruksha Roy Choudhury to chair this session. Over to you, sir.
Okay, thank you, Sumita Dutta, and warm greetings to all the paper presenters. Today is a really special day for all of us because after the successful completion of the two-day international webinar on African literature, we are back again with the international webinar on English literature from the margins of class, caste, race, gender, jointly hosted by Rishi Bankim Chandra College and Rishi Bankim Chandra Evening College. So this is session number 11. Principal Sir, Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Saha Mahasai, for encouraging us and motivating us every time. I also want to convey my special thanks to our Honorable Head of the Department, Professor Dr. Deval our esteemed Professor Chandranath Adhikari sir from English Gandhar and Professor Devdeep Banerjee. Today we have chosen the topic of literature from the margins. We all are, we most of all are acquainted with the topic, with the literature from the margins, that those who have been deprived, and those people who are always sidelined or driven to the background of the society, of the nations. And so, in this time of corona pandemic, it's a great opportunity through the Google Meet platform to conduct such international discussions forum to focus on such special topics on class, caste, race, gender, so that the marginalized section of the society, the peripheral sections of the society can be taken to the foreground from the back foot of the society. So this is the purpose of this webinar. And also after the successful completion of this entire session, we have a motto that we will publish an anthology with all the selected research papers with ISBN number. So this is our purpose. So this is going to be an enriching session on the literature from the margins of class, caste, race, and gender. So I would like now request our esteemed professor, Dr. Rupsha Rai Chaudhary, to chair the session. Thank you, Tonima. Thank you, Sujoy Sen Gupta.
Thank you, sir. I think Rupsha ma'am is still not here with us. So with your permission, I would like to introduce our first speaker, first paper presenter.
Yes, yes, obviously.
Okay. So our first paper presenter for today is Sudipta Bang.
Sujoy, 1 minute.
Okay, sir.
Hello. Okay, I'm interrupting you. I'm very much sorry that before we start, let us introduce paper presenters. That we have 11 paper presenters. First one is Sudipta Bhatt. Second one is Sudesh Nalha. Serial number 3. Serial number 4 is Sumita Bhatt. Serial number 6 is Suresh G. Gangotri. Serial number 7 is Toishali Vishwas. Number 8 Tony.10 minutes, which will be followed by question and
okay, Sujoy Sen Gupta, it's now over to you.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you for delineating the rules of this webinar. So our first paper presenter for today is Sudipta Bal. She is an assistant professor at Sarojini Naidu College for Women, Domdom. Her topic for discussion today would be Fashioning Femininity, the Discourse of Clothes to Construct a Feminine Identity in Victorian England. Ma'am, are you here with us?
Yes, I am.
Thank you, ma'am. You may now begin your presentation.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Hello and a very good evening to all of you. Today my topic of presentation is titled as Fashioning Femininity, the Discourse of Clothes to Construct a Feminine Identity in Victorian England. Am I visible? Is my presentation visible?
Yes, ma'am. You are. Yes, ma'am. You are now presenting.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Dress in the 19th century played a significant part in the performance of femininity in Victorian England to create the image of conventional and respectable Victorian womanhood. Clothing was an indicator of normative gender roles and idealized body types. In the words of sociologist Erwin Goffman, dressing at that time performed the function of an identity kit. Clothes were not merely aesthetic ornaments, but rather reflected society's hierarchy. The female body has long been idealized and objectified, but it reached its pinnacle in the Victorian era. Social rules and guidelines on how a woman should look and how she should be dressed objectified the female body and encoded femininity. With these rules, the trivial differences in physical anatomy between men and women were rather exaggerated through their clothed body. Samuel Butler provides the description of a conversation between two children looking at a picture of Adam and Eve in an illustrated Bible. "Which is Adam and which is Eve?" asks one child. "I don't know," answers the other, "but I could tell if they had their clothes worn." Fashion is an embodied practice that draws distinctions of gender, class, age, and status. The feminine characteristics of being fragile, submissive, inactive was further promoted through the heroines of literature of that time. In Vanity Fair, Thackeray finds the weakness of Amelia as her principal charm, quote-unquote, a kind of sweet submission and softness which seemed to appeal to each man she made for his sympathy and protection. In the Victorian era, the women were looked upon as the weaker sex, and the conservative gender roles restricted them within their homes with few rights and privileges. Society expected women to become good wives and mothers, to practice restraint and be subservient to men. The higher the class of women, the greater the pressure to be guided by these feminine qualities. In the Victorian era, the Industrial Revolution accelerated the economic growth, which facilitated the development of sewing machines and introduced synthetic dyes. The technological advancement in textile production introduced new machine-made light transparent fabrics in lower prices, and it provided women ample scope to embellish and decorate their clothes and adopt new styles. In the Victorian era, the apparel of women went through several changes. Among the various articles worn by women, the most prevalent were like tightly laced corset over a bodice, usually paired with embroideries and trims over layers of petticoat. And then this was put together with lacing or hook and eye. Zygote sleeves were in and out of fashion during this time. It had a puff on the shoulder, and the size of the puff changed in accordance with the trend. But as found, the popular zygote sleeves became much narrower by the late 1830s and 1840s, and were set, quote unquote, so low over the shoulder and so tightly encased the arm that it was virtually impossible to raise the arm to shoulder height or make an aggressive or threatening gesture. The limited range of arm movements increased the appearance of demure vulnerability and helplessness so often associated with the Victorian femme-fatales. Skirts also inhibited the movements of the women. During the 1830s, 1850s, dresses became bigger and more ornate, and skirts with flowers, fringes, and ribbons became wider. As the circumferences of the skirts grew, they required increasing numbers of petticoats in order to support them and give the dresses the desired dome shape. But it made the free movement of the legs difficult. By the mid-1850s, the crinolines or cage, as it was sometimes called, replaced the layers of petticoats, and the women got rid of the need of numerous petticoats. By the 1850s, the word crinoline began to mean the whole of the beehive-shaped skirt. The steel-hooked cage crinoline became extremely popular as it freed the legs, but it literally transformed women into caged animals surrounded by hoops of steel. It was used by all women, irrespective of their class, because of its low price. Skirts among all classes began to look rounded like gigantic domed beehives, and soon they reached maximum size. The crinolines were fire hazard. Week after week, stories of women burned to death as their crinolines caught fire were reported in the newspaper. The English Woman's Domestic Magazine on 1867 reported of 3,000 women getting burned to death annually and 20,000 injured because they wore the crinoline. Crinolines can be seen as a reflection of Victorian women's domestic enslavement and submissiveness. In her novel Orlando, Virginia Woolf describes the crinoline as the symbol of oppressive Victorian age. The cage crinolines was literally a prison that captivates women in repressive gender roles. In her 1977 essay on conservative Victorian gender roles, Helen E. Roberts commented on the difference between the clothing choices of men and women. Men were serious. They wore dark colors and little ornamentation. Women were frivolous. They wore light pastel colors, ribbons, lace, and bows. Men were active. Their clothes allowed movement. Women inactive. Their clothes inhibited movement. Men were strong. Their clothes emphasized broad chest and shoulders. Women delicate. Their clothing accentuated tiny waists, sloping shoulder, soft, rounded silhouette. Men were aggressive. Their clothing had sharp, definite lines and a clearly defined silhouette. Women were submissive. Their silhouette was indefinite, their clothing constricting. If the Victorian woman chose to wear the crinoline, it's solely because of their obsession to follow the obscure and impractical fashion goals set by the patriarchal society. Apart from the Tudor lines, the apparel which was worn the most attained the feminine frame was the corset. It retired part of the middle class women, and huge number of working class women used to use the corset on a regular basis. It was designed to attain the much desired small waist, which was vital to the creation of ideal feminine shape by changing the configuration of the body. Quote unquote, it exaggerated the differences in male and female anatomy by constricting the waist and enlarging the hips and the bust. It also constricted the diaphragm, forcing women to breathe from the upper part of the chest. From this resulted the peculiarly feminine heaving of the bosom, so lovingly described in popular novels. The small waist was associated with affluence, high social ranking, and it emphasized the need of women's self-regulation and the regulation of appetite. And it is this need for self-regulation that made the corset the ultimate symbol and instrument of female oppression. The degree of delicacy of the corset depended on how tightly it was laced. Tight lacing is a strict tightening of the corset that allowed the women to create the shape of a smaller and more circular waist. The widespread practice was largely disputed. There were numerous negative effects of the corset, including bodily deformation, as they displaced the organs from their natural positioning and made their wearer weak and languid, and its constant wear means the muscles underneath getting feeble. But women would undergo this pain in order to get the desirous feminine proportions. The female was conditioned from a very early age to conform to the submissive masochistic role that was symbolized by the corset. As Roberts pointed out, the English Woman's Domestic Magazine of September 1872 included a pattern and a sketch for a garment called baby stays, which were not worn, but all too often were tied very tightly. From baby stays, the young girl progressed to an unbound tight-fitting corset, which did not provide adequate allowance for growth. If the corset in its usual sense highlights sexuality, when it is tightless, it is inevitably highlights its more. The small waist provides erotic appeal by being a symbol of weakness and vulnerability, especially when compared to a man's strength. It represents both the sensual female body and the chaste virgin, and means control over female body. The corset can be seen as the fitting symbol of Victorian woman, oppressed, sexualized, under society's male dominance. In a society where marriage was the only option for a woman to lead a respectable life, it can be easily understood how important it was for a woman to attract a good husband. And for the concentrating on one's own appearance to look desirous inevitably become the norm, irrespective of the pain she has to go through. Movements like the Rational Dress Society tried to provide alternatives to this restricting female fashion, enslaving women into fragile femininity. But no real progress was attained before a considerable amount of time. Thank you.
Thank you, Shubhita, for an excellent presentation with the PowerPoint platform. So I would invite questions from the other participants. If you have any suggestions or any other thoughts, you can share with her.
Sorry,
ma'am.
Yes.
Can you hear me, ma'am? First of all, I would like to congratulate on your wonderful presentation. I would just like to know. What is your opinion on the returning of the corset? Nowadays, we see that the corset is returning into fashion, especially in Western countries. What is your opinion about that?
Well, the corset is surely returning, but the difference is huge. Earlier, the women were literally, they used to wear corset in order to get the fashionable silhouettes. That was the norm of the time. But nowadays, the way it is returning, it's the choice that a woman or a person is herself making. But there is no such norm as such, or rather, it won't affect her career or her life in a way if a woman does not choose to wear a corset. Earlier, if you do not...
Okay, sorry for interruption. Please go ahead.
It was associated with self-regulation and self-restraint, which was in a way thought or used to be thought as very feminine qualities at that time. So there's a lot of difference between how it was seen earlier and then how it is seen now.
Yes, and also nowadays it is being used to, even back then, corsets were often used to cure diseases like scoliosis,
yes,
and abnormal spine formation
diseases.
And all. Thank you, ma'am. If anyone has any questions, I see in the chat box, there are a few questions. Devadrita Mitra asks, what do you mean by fashioning femininity?
Well, femininity was thought of as a set of practices that was a form of ritualized submission. And fashion or clothing were the mode of expression of this submission. So by attaining that through their clothes, they used to practice the femininity. That's why I use the term fashioning femininity. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, if there are no more questions, then with the permission of our chairperson, can we move on to the next speaker?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Our next speaker for today is Krishna Shaha. She is a postgraduate student of Rishi Bhongkhamchandra Professional University. Sudeshna Shaha, I'll now request you to please present your presentation. Sudeshna Shaha, I don't see her in the list. No, she is not with us.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir, so that we can move to our next speaker.
And who would that be? I wonder. That would be me.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. So.
Sudeshna Saha is absent.
Yes, sir.
She isn't here yet. We can move her presentation at the last.
Okay.
If she comes out.
Okay, let's proceed.
Okay. So.
Sudeshna, ma'am, if you could please mute your mic.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you.
Okay. So our next speaker is Professor Shuja Shengupta. He is a faculty member of Sharada Maa Girls College, Barasat, West Bengal. His paper is on Becoming a Man Like No Other, English as a Masculine Mask in Ikuwano's Interesting Narrative. Sir.
Thank you, Sumita. I'd like to present, I don't have a PowerPoint presentation, so to say, but I'd like to just show you the picture of the man I'll be dealing with. Okay, is my screen visible? Can anyone confirm?
No, it's not visible. You are visible, but not your screen.
It's still not visible. Click on the share screen. Yeah,
I have.
Now it's visible.
Yes, so it took some time, sorry. Okay. Okay, so this is the man, Olaudah Ikuwano. My topic for discussion today is Becoming a Man Like No Other, English as a Masculine Mask in Olaudah Ikuwano's Interesting Narrative. Published in 1789, Olaudah Ikuwano's autobiography, The Interesting Narrative of the Life of Olaudah Ikuwano and Gustavus Vasa the African, was witness to a lot of furor. Being the first of its kind, that is, a slave narrative, the book garnered rapid public enthusiasm and became an international bestseller, thereby accelerating the commencement of an act for the abolition of the slave trade in 1807. The text has been subjected to numerous historical as well as literary analysis by various critics. Present-day scholars and critics have read Ikuwano text with and against the grain of post-colonial literary and cultural studies. Though numerous studies have attempted to explore and problematize Ikuwano's racial and cultural identity as a colored man and a slave in white culture, none has tried to shed light over Ikuwano's masculine identity. Hence, the title of the paper emphasizes on the words man and other as it purports to explore Ikuwano's masculinity as a manifestation of other/oriental man's performative bodily gestures. Over the past three decades or so, many studies on masculinity have emerged and they have examined man from a historical, cultural, sociological, spiritual, and psychological standpoint. These pioneering researches have opened up new avenues by providing us with multiple lenses to explore and problematize facile ascriptions of heteronormative manly values.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir, but your presentation is not visible.
Okay, I have stopped the presentation because I just only wanted to show you the picture.
Okay. Sorry, sir.
Providing us with multiple lenses to explore and problematize facile ascription of heteronormative manly values and assumptions on men's body. Drawing on postcolonial and gender theory frameworks, this paper seeks to explore how the Ikuyano's masculinity, or the lack thereof, as a colored ex-slave in 18th century English society, and how his acculturation of English becomes a desperate attempt at imbibing the ideals of hegemonic masculinity. Despite Ikuyano himself declaring the interesting narrative to be his autobiography, sometimes attempts have been made to separate the author from the narrator. However, this paper makes no such distinction and always identifies the narrator as Olaude Ikuyano himself. The interesting narrative of the life of Olaude Ikuyano begins with an introductory document in the form of a letter in which Ikuyano's voice emerges, cogently though humbly, to address, I quote, the Lord Spiritual and Temporal and the Commons of the Parliament of Great Britain. Apart from eulogizing the colonial enterprise, the letter also serves as an apologia for publishing, this is Ikuyano's words, a work so wholly devoid of literary merit. Quote ends, Ikuyano confronts the difficult task of reporting his lived experiences during years as a slave to an audience which refused to recognize him as a member of the society, and in fact considered him, I quote, an alien whose assertion of common humanity and civil rights conflicted with some of their basic beliefs. That this was a general view prevailing in the 18th century England is further made conspicuous by the condescending tone of the review that appeared in the Gentleman's Magazine in 1789. It quotes, these memoirs, written in very unequal style, place the writer on a par with the general mass of men in the subordinate stations of civilized society, and so prove that there is no general rule without an exception. Quote ends. This condescending attitude towards the Africans or the men of color was perpetuated in the works of such geniuses of racism as a Ryder Haggard or a Nicholas Ponsarat, not to mention the pronouncement of some of the giants of Western intellectual and political establishment, such as Hume, Thomas Jefferson, or Hegel, with his Africa comparable to a land of childhood, still enveloped in the dark mantle of the night as far as the development of the self-conscious theory was concerned. This is a quote by Thiong'o, by the way. Therefore, the amount of oppression and domination Ikuyano had to experience as a freed slave in a racist society can easily be conjectured. Throughout the narrative, Ikuyano describes his confrontation with several forms of violence and oppression meted out to the colored men, regardless of them being free or enslaved. In ancient Greece, sodomy was practiced by elder men as a means of exerting dominance over the body of less masculine younger men. In his essay Dover, Foucault and Greek Homosexuality, Penetration and the Truth of Sex, James Davidson quotes David Halperin. Greek and Roman men generally understood sex to be defined in terms of sexual penetration and phallic pleasure. The physical act of sex itself required, in their eyes, a polarization of the sexual partners into the categories of penetrator and penetrated, as well as a corresponding polarization of sexual roles into active and passive. Those roles, in turn, were correlated with superordinate and subordinate social status, with masculine and feminine gender styles. Phallic insertion functioned as a marker of male precedence. It also expressed social domination and seniority. Quote ends. Historian Paul Vane, in his article on Roman sexuality called La Famille et l'amour sous le Horum Empire Roma, published in the journal Annals, focuses on the act of penetration as a stabbing, rather than the different elevation of bodies in rear entry sodomy, so that any distinction between penetrated women and penetrated boys can be obliterated. Loosely drawing upon sodomy, it can be argued that since stabbing is essentially a form of physical violence, and it was physical violence that was exercised to dominate the slaves, it can be hypothesized that the enslavement of black men, I might remind thee that Ikuyano was introduced to slavery as a 10-year-old boy, can also be seen as an act of their emasculation. The social and cultural acceptance of sodomy in Greek society notwithstanding, and interpreting it solely as a violator-violated relationship, it can be argued that slavery implies an obliteration of the gender segregation between men and women, thereby negating the male slave's masculinity. With respect to white male masculinity, it weakens black males to an act of subordination, setting them up as sex objects. The perforations of incoherences that this argument fails to fill up, racism plays an active role to cement. While expatiating the masculine stereotype of the 18th century, George L. Moss writes, I quote, "The masculine stereotype was strengthened by the existence of a negative stereotype of men who not only failed to measure up to the ideal, but who in body and soul were its foil, projecting the exact opposite of true masculinity. Groups marginalized by society, such as Jews or Blacks, fulfilled this role," quote ends. It is important to note that Equiano describes his native religion and culture as being similar to that of the Jews. Therefore, it can be argued that slavery, racism, and antisemitism work combinedly as active agents of Equiano's emasculation. Equiano's affinity towards the British Empire, which Moss describes as an exceedingly masculine affair, is made explicit from the very onset of the novel, when Equiano, instead of engaging in opprobrium against the British Empire for his ignominious detention from his native land, actually engages in eulogy and regards the introduction to Christianity as more than enough compensation. He also considers his dignity of human nature exalted to the introduction of England and English. The shift of opinion between the narrator's younger and older self is peculiarly noteworthy. Whereas the younger narrator considered tawny or white-complexioned Negro children, I quote, "as far as related to their complexions as deformed," the older Christianized narrator saw the white men as superior, and he also expresses his desire to resemble them, to imbibe their spirit, and imitate their manners. His dissatisfaction with his own complexion receives expression in chapter 3, when he writes, I quote, "I had often observed that when her mother washed her face, it looked very rosy, but when she washed mine, it did not look so. I therefore tried oftentimes myself if I could not by washing make my face of the same color as my little playmate Mary. But it was all in vain, and now I began to be mortified at the difference in our complexions," quote ends. Onobugyo Thiong'o describes this affinity for the culture of others and abhorrence for one's own as the effect of the cultural bomb. He writes, "The effect of a cultural bomb is to annihilate a people's beliefs in their names, in their languages, in their environment, in their capacities, and ultimately in themselves. It makes them see their past as one wasteland of non-achievement, and it makes them want to distance themselves from that wasteland." Potence. It is an unconsciously determined process of internalization of what Fanon calls the inferiority complex of the colonized. It can also be interpreted as a representation of what Abdul Yan Muhammad calls hegemonic colonialism, a state in which, I quote, "the natives accept a version of the colonizer's entire system of values, attitudes, morality, institutions, and mode of production. This paper interprets Equiano's affinity for English as his desperate attempt to reinforce his masculine identity. Otto Jespersen claims in his book The Growth and Structure of English Language, "There is one expression that continually comes to my mind whenever I think of English language and compare it with others. It seems to me positively and expressively masculine. It is the language of a grown-up and has very little childish or feminine about it." Considering this with the fact that the knowledge of English saved him twice from unfair treatment and flogging, it can be argued that Equiano was quite successful in his endeavor to become an Englishman. He also associates Englishness with bravery, as he says, "I soon grew a stranger to terror of every kind, and was, in that respect at least, almost an Englishman." Equiano's view of himself as fundamentally English or white is consistent throughout the interesting narrative. He refers to England as the place where my heart has always been. Upon being addressed by an Indian prince as a white man, he does not even comment, he has already subconsciously placed himself in the same category. But according to Equiano's repeated proclamation of his disgust with his own complexion, Tanya Caldwell writes, "incessant and consistent repudiation of the future that brands him as an outsider reveals the depth of his identification with the culture by which he has been shaped." Potence. His anglicization allows Equiano to move himself, both literally and literally, from the European cultural margins to a culturally central position. But, as Homi K. Bhabha points out in The Location on Culture, there is always a crucial difference between being English and being anglicized. The question remains whether or not, in his attempt to become English, Equiano ends up with Bhabha's mimic. Susan Marin argues that despite Equiano's ostensible position as a cultural insider, a loyal British social informant that is, he remains marginalized. Marin interprets Equiano's purchase of his own freedom as a rebirth into social life, but that is paradoxically a futile act because both slaves and freed blacks continue to occupy liminal space in British society. Neither group is a candidate for cultural transformation, since they are neither rooted Africans nor Europeans, they remain culturally adrift. Equiano's transformation from being a property to owning property can be seen as another attempt on his part to imbibe the hegemonic ideals of masculinity. The very first property he owns after obtaining his freedom is himself, that is, his body. His own language is indicative of the fact that he does not so much obtain freedom as he purchases himself as a slave. He becomes, I quote, my own master. He goes to Sierra Leone with Dr. Arvin, where he is charged with the supervision of a plantation on the Mosquito Shoal. Of his one recorded foray into slave purchasing, Piano states, I went with the doctor on board a Guinea man to purchase some slaves to carry with us and cultivate a plantation, and I chose them all of my own countrymen. He claims to have treated the slaves with care and affection, and attempted to comfort the poor creatures and render their condition easy. Marion Rust argues that this reference to the slaves as poor creatures indicates the degree to which he approximated imperialist economic ethics. This act of purchasing slaves himself also proves that Equiano's objection was not so much with the institution of slavery itself, but with the cruel, inhuman treatment meted out to the slaves, and in so doing, threatened the economic and political stability of Britain's colonial empire. Equiano himself numerous times engages in eulogy of Robert King, who used to keep his slaves well fed, thereby getting more labor out of them.
Please wrap up your paper.
I'm almost done. Francis Smith Foster disparages him by saying, Equiano rarely alters the dispassionate and modest tone of his prefatory remarks. His denial of personal involvement beyond the desire to please friends and to make a small contribution to the interests of humanity is in accordance with accepted standards of gentlemanly humanitarianism. Indeed, when he applies to become a missionary himself in Africa to ostensibly aid in the upliftment of the condition of the natives, he actually works as an agent to help open up the continent to trade. Equiano argues in favor of the abolition of the slave trade as a necessary step towards a more lucrative exploitation of Africa's human and natural resources. At this point, according to Geraldine Murphy, Equiano adopts the imperial gaze. It is an indication of the extent of Equiano's absorption of the ethos of the white society that makes him speak in an entrepreneurial voice. It can be argued that Equiano's attempt at shouldering the white man's burden is actually an attempt at gaining legitimacy for his masculinity. Equiano's marriage to a white woman also seems to be a reaffirmation of the racial myth of, I quote Aurelius here, black men imagined as peripatetic phalluses with unrequited desire for their denied object, white women. In his marriage too, Equiano maintains and reaffirms the viewpoints of a white man. Anthony J. Lemel, citing Oliver Cox, argues, whites held a ruling class position and this made their women attractive to subordinated men. In other words, the attraction was in the minds of the men who found the women attractive. They believed, because of the women's social position, they were the most attractive. This suggests that the men objectified the women. Fra Fanon explains the sexual desire for white women among black men as a part of a process of jealousy. This desire to possess the position of white men, as well as the objectification of white women, can be seen as a marker of complicit masculinity. As Connell puts it, the number of men rigorously practicing the hegemonic pattern may be quite small, yet the majority of men gain from its hegemony since they benefit from the patriarchal dividend, the advantage men in general gain from the overall subordination of men. I come to my conclusion. On the basis of the arguments built above, it can be asserted that despite Equiano's numerous attempts at imbibing the hegemonic ideals of the Englishman's masculinity through language, acculturation and behavioral mimicry, his identity as a black man limits his masculine performance to complicity and he barely transcends his otherness. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Sujarshan Gupta, for his excellent presentation on the interesting narrative of the life of Olaudua Equiano. It's an excellent book by the author. Autobiography that in the book he has attempted how to become an independent man and how to get independence from slavery. And Sujoy, I think travel also plays a key role in the book. Is it? Is it?
It's not. Yes, just sir. It does.
Okay. So it
can become. I specifically wanted to emphasize on the masculine, I mean, his gender identity. I mean, the way he performs himself, it's masculine.
Okay. Actually, travel is my research area, so I just shared my thoughts with you. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for your excellent presentation, Sujarshan Gupta. Our next paper presenter, and before I start, I want to introduce with you, we are very much fortunate that Professor Rupsa Roy Chaudhary, Department of English, Rishi Bankimchandra College, has just joined with us. I welcome Professor Rupsa Roy Chaudhary. Thank you, ma'am, for joining us. And
thank
our
you,
next
yes.
our next paper presenter is Sumita Dotto. Sumita Dotto is here with us. Sumita Dotto,
yes, sir.
Her she is also our student coordinator. She is a student of MA, fourth semester, Rishi Bankimchandra College. And the title of her paper is The God of Small Things, Realistic Portrayal of Subaltern and Gender Discrimination, Intersectionism. Okay.
Just a moment, sir. T.S. sir. And my apologies to Sumita as well. I just wanted to comment one thing to the previous paper that was presented by Sujarshan Gupta. That is, this is not a question. This is actually a rather appreciative comment that you took up in case of colonialism, the male body. In gender studies, I think we have over-exhausted, though not unnecessarily, talking about the female body and how that works. And like, it was a very welcome change to see how the male body function, and particularly in context of taboo subjects like sodomy in case of colonialism. So I just wanted to thank you for taking up this rather unconventional subject. Over to you, Sumita. I'm very
Thank
sorry
you.
For stopping you. Please continue.
No, ma'am. Okay. May I start? May I start, ma'am?
Yes.
Yes, please.
Okay. Good afternoon to all. I am Sumita Dotto of Rishi Bankimchandra College Department of English. So now I'm going to present my screen. Is it visible?
Yeah, it is visible.
Yes, Sumita.
Okay. So here is the title of my paper. That is Arundhati Roy is the God of Small Things, Realistic Portrayal of Subaltern, Gender Discrimination, Intersectionalism, A Post-Colonial Perspective, A Critical Overview. In this paper, my primary objective is to show how private and public lives are intertwined with one another. The private lives are regulated by the social, political, and religious order of the day. Therefore, it sheds lights on the touchables and untouchables in the society. In addition to this work, I will also draw attention to the women question and on ethnicity. The age-old ideology of patriarchy reflects in their every way and acts of society. Papachi and Chakku stood as the icon for the male chauvinism of Indian society. In India, even today, evils of caste and class, patriarchal operations, feed and depend on each other, and Perutha, being the son of untouchable, being the subaltern, meets death. Roy's the novel, considered as a partial autobiographical and semi-biographical novel, it highlights untouchability, casteism, intersectionalism, negligence. Both women and untouchables share the common platform of the society called subaltern, confronted exploitation, humiliation, maltreatment from chauvinism. In this novel, as a modernist, Roy has incorporated many of its devices and agencies and voices in her writing. Here, in this slide, by referring the characters, I am going to give a brief introduction and substance of the story. So, the novel opens abruptly with the fascinating description of Ayamanam, its surrounding, and monsoon rain. This is about a family living in Ayamanam, a town in the state of Kerala. The story is non-chronological in its structure. Rahil and Istha are twins of Ammu living with their grandmother Mamachi, great-aunt baby Kochamma, and uncle Chakku. Ammu is divorced when her children were 2 years old. Their father lives in Kolkata. The family is awaiting for the arrival of Chakku's ex-wife and daughter Margaret and Sophie Mui, respectively, who are staying in London. As Margaret's second husband Joe died, therefore Chakku invited them to Ayamanam for the Christmas so that the loss might be covered. Papachi, husband of Mamachi, was an ill-tempered, a man of kids of earlier who behaved like a decent man but demonstrated his male ego and bourgeois mentality when he tyrannizes his wife and children. Mamaji leads a pickle making business without Papaji's consent after his retirement, and there Ammu met the untouchable Velta, who is a good skilled mechanic and with whom Ammu had a private affinity. In The God of Small Things, Roy has presented women with a range of possibilities regarding their outlook on life and society. Some are seen as complacent, resistant, and even transgressing the dominant order of the times. Roy does not idealize or criticize any of them. Rather, portrays them as having complex traits. She has shown how each of them has been dominated in some way or the other by the system of oppression. But Roy gives them voice and agency, who struggle for their right to possess a sense of identity. Let us examine some of the characters of the novel to make this point clearer. Okay, Mamaji is first seen as a submissive and docile woman who is quite traditional in her views of life. She silently bears the torture of her husband, who used to beat her regularly, and she never opposed him. But she finds her way out all by herself. She transcends the limit imposed upon her by the society and emerges out to be an independent when she starts her business of pickle making in her kitchen without Papaji's consent. This act can be regarded as an agency through which Mamaji tries to carry out her idea without her husband's and society's opinion. Mamaji's emancipation is a little different from others. She adopts a more indirect and subtle way of doing things such actually works for her. Baby Kochamma is more indirect in her mode of operating things. Her life is less constrained as she is not under any marital commitment. She does not have a man to submit to, but all her life she remains heartbroken because of her unreciprocated love of Father Mulligan. The values and modes of the society may influence her life, but she remains unrestricted in her will to act as she wanted. She exercises her agency all the time to influence the lives of the others. This is seen in her manipulative nature, which she uses to control other people in her family and even outside it. Considering the other female characters in the novel, Ammu can be regarded as a marginalized figure. She is a divorced woman who is left with two children to suffer. Utterly helpless, she comes to her father's house where she is badly treated with her twins. During her youth, Ammu did not conform to the rules imposed on her by the family or the society. She quickly accepts the first proposal made to her and marries a person outside the religion. She took her own decision, and later when things went wrong after her marriage, she divorced him as well. Even her children are marginalized to a great extent. Given the oppressive patriarchal structure, the novel shows how a woman's social and economic agency is not welcomed, but condemned and undervalued. For instance, we can take example as Mamaji's thriving pickle and jam business is ignominious to old Papaji, and for revenge, he beats her with a brass flower vase every night. And when he knows visitors are expected, he seals buttons that are not missing onto the shirt, but to create an impression as if Mamaji neglects him. As Prasad notes, Papaji is a man of schizophrenia. Papaji's daughter Ammu is a woman with self-confidence, defiant, also oppressed and deprived of the opportunity to study and have an exposure like her own brother Chaku. She often outsmarts him, though he is educated from Oxford. Papaji insisted that a college education was an unnecessary expense for a girl, so Ammu had no choice. As a result of this, then she marries a Bengali Hindu man who is fully blown alcoholic. He even starts physically abusing her. In one of the incidents, we must note that he even asks her to satisfy his boss, Mr. Hollick's lust to save his job. Mr. Hollick's temperament, as portrayed in the novel, so I'm quoting it from the text, that is, "You are a very lucky man, you know, wonderful family, beautiful children, such an attractive wife, an extremely attractive wife," unquote. He also suggests him to send Ammu to look after him. Ammu took her own decision and divorced him and returned to Armenia to her maternal house. But now she has been disinherited from the family's property by Chako, her brother, who says that she has no legal right to inherit the factory or the house. But Chako at the same time did the same thing, divorced her wife, returned to his parents' house, but now undertakes the pickle and jam business. It's a great irony and gender discrimination that a daughter estranged from the husband is tortured and tyrannized in parents' house, but on the other hand, an estranged son, Chako, not only receives warm welcome, but also remains the rightful inheritor of the family's wealth and fortune. The theoretical approach we take to this paper, to read the interrelation of caste, class, and gender issues in some of the new English fiction is a theory of intersectionality. The term intersectionality was coined by American feminist academic Kimberly Crenshaw in an article published in 1989 on violence against women of color in the lower classes in the United States. Intersectionality or intersectionalism is the study of the intersections between different groups of minorities, especially the study of intersections of multiple systems of oppression or discrimination. Intersectionality holds that the classical conceptualization of oppression within society, such as racism, sexism, homophobia, and religion, do not act independently of one another. Instead, these forms of oppression interrelate, creating a system of oppression that reflects the intersection of multiple forms of discrimination. The God of small thing is a predicament of an untouchable and subaltern in Indian society, where Velutha is a representative of an untouchable, a Dalit or suppressed, who is gifted with good carpentry and mechanic skills. In spite of his skills, he has unfortunately been paid less than touchable carpenters in the factory. The untouchable Velutha's affair with a high-class lady is unthinkable and highly offensive according to the society. They break old age norms and are punished for it by the society. Even the woman of the family, even the woman of the family see nothing wrong in man's needs, quote unquote, but the same condition do not apply to Ammu when she loves the untouchable man. Instead, the state, family, and religion all conspire against her to eliminate this act of deference. Intercaste marriages rarely happens in the societies, though most of the thinkers accept that nowadays conditions are more moderated with the help of law and order, but people do not prefer intercaste marriages. If anybody takes the bold step to be humiliated, sometimes even killed under the sophisticated title of honor killing. Though most of us know about this phenomenon, still I would like to give a brief introduction of it and how the God of small thing relates to the issue of honor killing. So, an honor killing or shame killing is the murder of a member of the family due to the perpetrator's belief that the victim has brought shame or dishonor upon the family, or has violated the principles of a community or a religion with an honor culture. For restraining the glory of the family, Baby Kuchamma knowingly misinterpreted Velutha and Ammu's relationship to save the honor of the family in the eyes of the inspector, Thomas Matthews. The police arrived and arrested Velutha and beat him so inhumanly that he almost died. Baby Kuchamma also forces the children to confirm the false statement she made at the police station. Velutha died next day at prison. Ammu and her children are held responsible by Chako for Sophie's death. Ammu leaves Aminam to look for a job while Rahil stays there. Ammu finds no work and she dies of ill health in a lodge with no one by her side. And what should it be called? Is this a way to recapture family's glory, or is it an indirect way of honor? Post-colonial literature deals with the distortion of cultures by the influences of the colonization. The post-colonial writers exposed the appropriate images, scenes, traditions of the colonized countries, along with their problems, perplexities, complexities in the form of otherness and independence. A type of cultural criticism, post-colonial criticism, usually involves the analysis of literary texts produced in countries and cultures that they have come under the control of European colonial powers. However, despite the fact that Roy's characters are haunted by the disturbing shadow of the colonial past, most obvious in the linguistic inheritance of British colonialism and capitalism enterprises, Roy rewrites and challenges this heritage and breaks the religious and social boundaries. Interracial marriages, cross-class affairs, as well as transgressive sexuality.
Roy, Sumita, start wrapping up, please.
Sumita, yes, sir. Roy tests the possibility of a true negotiation of culture, races, and sexes, a genuine hybridity. Arundhati Roy's novel exposes the constant struggle of women against their incessant exploitation and torture at the hands of male-dominated society. The novel articulates the voice of all those who are relegated to the margins of the society. To conclude, we find that Arundhati Roy has a deep concern for small things, that is, victims of socio-political, economic, and cultural practices. Amitabh Roy is right when he writes, the novel can be viewed as a tale of terror that destroyed the lives of Velutha and Ammu, but also as a tale of how Esther and Rahel survived. Thank you.
Sir, please unmute yourself, sir.
Now I invite questions or any suggestions from other participants. If you have any queries or questions, it was an excellent presentation, PPT presentation by our PT student Sumita Dutta on God of Small Things. It's an excellent novel that that tells the stories of Indian history, Indian politics, class, caste, cultural tensions, communal tensions, forbidden love, misogyny, social discrimination. Okay, Sumita, one thing I saw in your PPT, it was about honor killing, is it?
Yes, yes, sir.
Would you please tell something about that honor killing?
Sir, how it relates to the story of the God of Small Things? Sir, as we can see in this novel that Ammu and Velutha the Untouchable had an affair and which is not acceptable for the society. So Ammu's great aunt Baby Kochamma misinterpreted about the relationship between Ammu and Velutha to the inspector of Thomas Matthew, and for that Velutha bit so inhumanly and he died the next day in the prison. And Ammu left Ayamena for their job, for her job, and at lodge for her ill health, he died. So indirectly, it is one kind of honor killing, we can say.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Sumita Dutta,
for your
excellent presentation, and thank you for being with us here. Our next presenter is Suparna Roy. Suparna Roy.
Yes, sir. I'm present. Hello, sir. I cannot hear anything.
Department of English, Sundar University, Ludhia. And okay, now we over to Sudai. Okay.
Yes, sir. I think you are having some technical. You are having some network issues, sir. Okay, Suparna, please start. Suparna's topic for discussion today is English literature from the margins of class, caste, race, and gender. And she is a PG final semester student of Kollam University. Suparna, over to you.
Thank you. Okay. Good evening, chairpersons and everyone. Keeping in mind the time constraints, I'm going to focus on and brief you important aspects of my paper. My topic for presentation is English literature from the margins of class, caste, race, and gender. And I'm going to focus on Maheshwara Devi's Rudali to expand this particular topic of mine. And I begin. Patriarchy, if considered a mutating, drug-resistant virus and the source of all inequalities, constructed identities, and restrictions and markers for all bodies in a society, then marginalization, a product of power regimes, is used to operate, control, and construct bodies and deprive them of their basic rights. Marginalization is, in broader operation to segregate and mark bodies on the basis of caste, class, gender, ethnicity, religion, social, cultural, economic, creed, and other factors. Maheswata Devi's Rudale, 1993, is a short fiction that vividly presents the voiceless and subjugated subalterns in the remote village of Rajasthan. The story revolves on making valueless emotion the most valued. It shows how pricing of tears can lead to triumph. Rudalis are rented by rich families during death ceremony, and they sell their tears to earn money. This short fiction reflects on how body, which remains under extreme restrictions, transgresses all and reconstructs the identity of her to emerge as more powerful, empowered woman. Focusing on three most important categories of marginalization as presented in Rudali, caste, class, and gender, we can analyze how numerous lives are forced to move to periphery or edge of the society to struggle and continue living, how their identities are stigmatized, the desires, dreams, voices are crumbled into invisibility and silences. The spectrum of marginalization in India is perhaps so intricately designed that when it gets unfolded, it reflects all the swelling lies which gets veiled by this intricate design of culture, power, and aesthetics. Literature which deals with this intricately marginalized life in any sector is regarded as literature from the margins or marginal literature. Unlike other literary branches which focuses on the creative interpretation of Indian community, its culture and formulation and projection of Indian image, marginal literature delves into the stratified layers to give a vivid expression of the reality of our Indian society that only plays with the victims of caste, class, and gender. The concept of subaltern has become prominent in our present scenario of marginalized literature as presented in Times of India, where Swati Shinde says, as Antonio Gramsci regarded, subaltern refers to that marginalized culture which flourished away from the mainstream literature. Now, it is important to be free to express one's mind, so that an individual, a person, a human, is able to live with their own individualized identity and not like an unnamed body in heels. In this regard, what Gopal Guru says regarding Dalits in his article, Freedom of Expression and the Life of Dalit Mind, is very valuable. As he questions, and I quote from his article, under what conditions does the freedom of expression enable the Dalit to live a life of the mind? Does the foregrounding of the body and the elevation of the bodily expression ellipses dignity and emancipation? Devi, her creative exploration somewhere expresses the predicament of the lives of the subaltern in her work Rudali. Feminism, to speak broadly, is an antidote to patriarchy, a platform which stands to raise a voice for all the oppressed who are not given equal rights in the society like the rest accepted counterparts, bracket men. In Devi's short fiction, which represents the life of the subaltern in Rajasthan, we can see how women are doubly subjugated, which means that a woman is not only subjugated because of her gender, but also because of her caste, Dalit, her class, poor, and her designation as a widow woman. This is to say that the protagonist Sanichari is subjugated for being a Dalit and a poor widow woman. The manner in which Devi dices to feminism to reconstruct the identities of the subalterns, particularly women, get vividly expressed in Sanichari's struggle. And I quote from the book, Sanichari was a ganju by caste. Like the other villagers, her life too was lived in a desperate poverty. The story begins focusing on the hardships that the subalterns have to suffer in the Tahar village of Rajasthan. The social setup and the immense suffering that Devi portrays in Rudali, depicting the life of the low-caste, poor, widow women, Sanchari, who finally realize that, and I quote from the book, perhaps her tears had been reserved for the time when she would have to feed herself by selling them. Devi put an immense effort to depict through Sanchari the lives of the lower-caste women in Tahar. And I quote from the book, her mother-in-law died of great pain. Ellipses crying out over and over, food, give me food. The concept of woman is typically essentialized rather than intersectionalized. Body plays an important concept in constructing a woman's identity, quote unquote, a woman's identity. However, our society failed to realize that bodies are all words whose meanings can and always change and evolve. One can never grasp the exact correct definition of any quote unquote body defined as a definite form. As Judith Butler argues in Gender Trouble 1990 regarding the metaphysics of substance, in which she writes about the definition of self, and quotes from one of the critics of metaphysics of substance, Michael Hart, that body is just a word, and I quote from the book, the subject, the self, the individual, are just so many false concepts. Since they transform into substances, fictitious unities having at start only a linguistic reality. The woman here of Rudali creates their identity beyond this or that identity society offers them through their work as Rudalis. This constructive, unified identity gives them freedom, offers an identity beyond caste, class, and gender. Rudali gives us a clear glimpse of how patriarchy has created and established a society where the definition of a woman is all body. As Simone de Beauvoir writes in The Second Sex, 1949, that men are considered universal, so are left unmarked, while woman becomes woman because they are marked, restricted, and norms are imposed upon them. The plight of a woman in this society is too harsh. The dichotomy of either a wife or a hoe rule their bodies. Like when Dulan's wife gave the example of Gambhir Singh saying, and I quote from the book, "This war treats the laborers and whores alike. They trade them into mud. The worst is Gambhir Singh. He kept a whore, had a daughter by her. A whore's daughter is a whore. Practice your profession and support yourself. The women and their body is priced from a five rupee whore to a 5 paisa whore," unquote. Sanichari's journey from the unvalued labor, poor, widowed, lower class woman to show how emotions can make the strongest image of a woman and help her to earn her livelihood, who demanded money depending on her levels of expressing her emotions. And I quote from the book, "Just for wailing, one kind of rate. Wailing and rolling on ground, 5 rupees, 1 sitka. Wailing, rolling on ground and beating one's head, 5 rupees, 2 sitkas. Wailing and beating one's breast, ellipsis charge is 6 rupees. Ellipsis plain black cloth." Sanichari transgresses at every step and passes as human before a woman. Be it not crying while losing the closest person of life, or when she dared to question, and I quote from the book, "But I heard that the upper class never got smallpox, that it was a disease of the poor and the lower class. That's why we take government's vaccination and appease the gods." Davis' remarkable portrayal of Sanichari, who questioned the chaotic devices of power, interrogated and established that disease is not related to caste. What Sanichari had now was not the sadness of losing anyone, but rather devouring fear to be penniless. She was only afraid not to have money, to have no food, to remain hungry as she has grown old. So when she got the news that Bikini was dead, and I quote from the book, "She felt a landslide within." Sanichari felt so, not because she felt grief, but a devouring fear. Bikini's death affected her livelihood, her profession. That's why she is experiencing this fear. And why, after all? Because she is old, unquote. Despite her struggles and hardships, fears and oppression, Sanichari kept on fighting, for her life was nothing less than a battle. And I quote from the book, "Everything in this life is a battle, particularly when she was a subaltern old woman. Being old, being a woman, being a low caste, being a widow, being poor, she had to overcome all various forms of food." Devi portrayed Sanichari's chronic condition and powered the voice of the subaltern through loud wailings, which got priced during the burial ceremonies. Sanichari therefore decided to move on and take up Bikini's part of the job too, and wed herself to gather up the whore wailing up in the upcoming burial ceremony. Devi made Sanichari transgress this binary of right, wrong, this, that, and before Sanichari. And therefore Sanichari, and I quote from the book, felt no embarrassment about asking directions to the red light area. Consideration of the stomach are more important than anything else. By doing this, Devi deconstructs the fact that a body does not need to adhere itself to the socially constructed principles than the human necessities like hunger. As Dulan's wife said to Sanichari, and I quote from the book, "Don't weigh right and wrong so much. Ellipsis, we understand hunger." So Sanichari, from being a voiceless, becomes a voice to Dali, as it gets prominent in the last stanza, while Gulpa then remains a soliciting client. And I quote the last stanza, "Gambhir's corpse stank of rotten flesh. The Ranji's Rudalis surrounded his swollen corpse and started wailing, hitting their heads on ground. The Gomasa began to weep tears of sorrow. Nothing will be left. Cunning Sanichari, hitting their heads meant they had to be paid double. While hitting her head on the ground and wailing loudly, Gulpa then turned her eyes in the direction of the nephew, cast him a leering wink and grinned. Then, listening to Sanichari's cry, she rejoined the chorus. A text can have infinite cruelty.
Aparna, please start wrapping up.
Yes, sir. I'm just.
Please start wrapping up.
Yes, sir. A text can have infinite plurality of meanings, and it evolves and changes as there is no particular point where the meaning can be fixed. Thus, the short fiction depicts every woman figure's struggle to exist, to earn shelter, respect, identity. The earning of respect of these bodies remain a question, but this invaluable bodies transfers the marital, social, sexual bodies of respectability, this body starts earning value in terms of money and position. As Anjum Patial says in The Metamorphosis of Rudali, that Sanichari is a hard-working ellipsis. She is not helpless victim. Sanichari is a play, long-suffering, enduring strike equals a seminal mother courage, a theatre image comfortable and familiar to the urban audiences. Thank you. Hello? Am I audible?
Okay, thank you, yes, Suparna.
Yes, sir.
Okay, it's over to Sujay. It's over to you. Okay. You chair the session.
Oh, no, sir. Actually, I thought that you were having some network issues. That's why I was going to dinner.
Okay, you continue. You continue. No problem. You continue. You can continue.
Okay. So, if anyone has any questions for Suparna, you can either unmute your mic and ask that to her, or you can just write in the chat box. Suparna, it was a wonderful presentation, and apparently no one has any questions for you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Now we move on to our next speaker, Suresh G. Gangotri. Suresh G. Gangotri is a lecturer of Sangoli Rayanna First Grade Constituent College, Belagavi. And his topic for discussion today is the role of orature in African sociocultural space. Are you here, Suresh? Professor Suresh? I think she isn't here. So we have to move on to our next participant, that is Toishali Bishash. Toishali Bishash?
Yes, sir, I'm present.
Okay. Toishali Bishash is a PG student from Rishi Bankimchandra College, Nuihati, and her topic for discussion today is Balance, the Taste, and Analysis of Om Prakash Valmiki's Jutan. Toishali, you may continue now.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Sir, you can start. Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, everyone. Now I'll be presenting my paper. Sir, is my screen presentable?
Yes, we can see it. Go on.
So we can see that education as a class barrier, the chronicles of text makes man in this real world. The basic begins from survival, then comes education. Education stands as the pillar of the nation. India, following the path, has made it compulsory and attainable for every section of the society to get basic education. But here lies the question. Whether the people had accepted the word equality or not. Om Prakash Valmiki in his Jhutan states that he himself has been subjected to teasing, humiliation and bullying for being enrolled in school. Government allotted schools officially, but in reality, they still had to be under pressure and constant wrath were part of their daily life. Though being enrolled in the classes, still they had to sweep the entire school just because of their class. Education in written form made their way, but the mindset was far behind. They were given lower marks because of the class. A new type of discrimination made its way. The rich class started getting richer with all their opportunities and making the poor poorer. Talents get challenged and lack of scope make them stay in their own zone. They are marginalized as they are out of the competition already, and it is beautifully presented in a film, Pariksha. Education being the divider divides the people nowadays in sections of society, making them margins and breaking them too. People have slowly started giving importance to education, but this arouses a new kind of problem, class discrimination. After India got independence, the new made morals created more complicated problems. The rules got changed, but the mindset was still etched in their behavior customs. In Jhutan, it was clearly shown how the lower class people are treated, though being on the same platform as the upper class people. The new age people started recognizing their democratic rights, but were still under the cloud of the class barriers. The upper class people, in their attitudes, behavior, practices, keeps on implementing their supremacy upon the lower class people. Parasite, an Oscar-winning film, shows how a small situation reflects upon the lower class people and the high society. The class anxiety is the old age evil that transits into the society, and that the cure is yet to be discovered. Capitalism is powerfully explored by filmmakers by their masterpieces, The Florida Project, The Good Girls, and many more. Entertainment being a major influence, it becomes a part of the people's lives immediately. And in a study, Benjamin Inequality, it showed that the movies depict social class equality transparently. Over 30% characters are portrayed as upper class, but only 4% are portrayed as poor. The upper class is portrayed as only being able to keep their class position if they opted for things below their social position. The upper class started snatching the opportunities provided to the lower class people in every possible way. The elite began in the marginalizer position, started marginalizing the outcast in a very shrewd manner. The government schools are a classic example of them. The private education system started gaining weight among the rich class as they were connecting more opportunities and favors in the context of globalization. The lower class people were outcast by the new domain that it is the government facilitated education that gives a very basic exposure to the lower class people. The English as a language still has its domain over the countries which were under British rule. Class distinction is also a very prevalent thing that is presented in a very stereotypical way. It is presented as a perfect reflection of character and ambition. The films such as Parasite, Hustler, Knives Out clearly pointed out and hilariously marked at the marginalized characters, overpowering antagonists who are quite equally not villainous, but instead just wealthy, as while grabbing the poles of the ever-widening income gap and playing jump rope with the fragile line connecting both the world's rich and the poor. An epic scene in Parasite shows how rain and heavy showers reflect in the lives of the lower and the upper class. The representation of the upper class passes a comment stating that because of the rain and thunder showers, the next day weather becomes comfortable to them, whereas in the parallel universe, the lower class people lack basic facilities like food and shelter. This strikes hard in the mind of the audience and holds two worlds in the same universe. The symbiotic relationship between the wealthy Park family and the destitute Kim clan shows that the class discrimination in the new age world. The poor family sees themselves as a high qualified individual itself proves the point that the higher class people tend to take the so-called highly class and qualified people only, who are only talented. They do not show any urge to pull out the socially marginalized people into the mainstream, but they only keep on rotating in their own circle and orbit. This mentality prevails all over nowadays. The rich class has made it very clear that the boundary between the two worlds is indistinct. Unless and until one is famous or highly qualified, according to their status, one is not welcomed. The recommendation part from other sources stands out to be a very important part in their lives. Jude the Obscure also shows Jude, the protagonist, idolizes going to Christ Minister in order to get a new life and uplift his social status. He dreams of being a university graduate. In this process, loses everything in return. Education can change the lives. This basic idea gets hitched in his immature childish brain, but the roads to fulfill them were closed by the higher class people by changing the rules and regulations of the university. By the act, Hardy, being a stonesman person with a salary of 10,000 pounds per year, it was doubtful whether he could be able to afford Cambridge, and this reflected too in Jude. The lower class gained education, but it was only limited to government school only, whereas the rich class attended international schools. The difference, the invisible gap, remained same. Jude is still prevalent to us as he, being an outsider too, was denied access to improvement and social advancement. The particularities may have changed, but everyone's station has remained the same. The father tries to place his son, academically brilliant son, in the high society school as he feels that his son will fall far behind. So the ambitious father starts making all the odds even on the road and makes it happen. But the rich classy parents could not accept the fact that the rickshaw puller's son become the topper of the class and his talent is questioned immediately. This brings out the basic question now. Is the right to education for everyone is still the same in the country and in the larger prospects in the world? Education too has been divided between classes, the elite class education for the higher class people and the basic primary ones for the lower class. This had made all the differences now in their lives. A new discrimination started taking place in the society and it is spreading at an alarming rate. Education is for everyone, but the final test is taken on the class divide of our pseudo society. English language education can only make lives better and can make them out of this class barrier is shown highly and in reality too. People are nowadays running after this. Classy people oppose this as they feel that if the lower class people start mingling in their social status, then the powers will be subdued and there will be no class divide in which they would be implying their authority. It is well known to us that if everyone belongs to the same strand of the social ladder, there will be no higher class and no lower class, and the ruling authority will miss their so-called position. So with time, the borderline keeps on shrinking along with widening it too. New ways of discrimination will prevail their way, like education discrimination started. In the new age world, it is very projected. In Bama Sangati also, it is projected whether the protagonist, a lady, after receiving education, also is referred to as a Dalit because of her social and economic position. In Munshi Premchand's novel, Godan, also sometimes the class takes over the caste, depicting classic examples. In Vedic age, people would easily change their class status, but nowadays it is quite hefty to change the social speculations. The boy, Bulbul Kumar, in
Socially, Pariksha, please start wrapping up.
Yes, sir.
Please start wrapping up.
People are now trying to make their maximum in order to make them fit in the new age world. In UNESCO, also, there is no limit for the voting rights. It is implied that the law, but people made it clear that they will make their own rules and regulations and only allow their people to invade in the group. In the abroad countries, a student is allotted money at the end of the school year on the basis of their financial condition and not on the basis of their educational curriculum. So at the end, the poor student gets poorer and the rich kid gets a bulky share. This is by far the worst type of discrimination, as education itself teaches us and enlightens us for a brighter and better society and future. And this only is showing us the most ugly side. Education is not the tool which is measured through classiness and manners, but it is a thing to enlighten ourselves, that it should be our motivation in life to do better for the society. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Toshali, for your excellent presentation. Okay, Toshali, could you find the relate this text of Jutan with Bama's Karuppu?
Yes, sir.
Could you relate your text, the Jutan, with Bama's Karuppu?
Yes, sir, I can relate with it, because the marginalized section of the society can be related in all the Dalit texts. Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Toshali. Our next presenter is Tonima Nath. Tonima Nath.
Good evening, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah. Yes, you are audible.
Okay. Is my presentation visible, sir?
Yes, it's visible.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. I am Tonima Nath, PG student from RBC College. My topic is, how far Sharatchandra Chattopadhyay's short story, Mahesh, can be considered as a Dalit literature? So at first, I will focus on who Dalit is. Dalit is one who has suffered Dalan and Daman, oppression and victimization. They are oppressed, exploited, marginalized people of our society. They even are denied to human rights of the society. The word Dalit rests on a social and cultural foundation of those people who before the use of the term Dalit was considered as jatis like Chandal, Shudra, Harijan, the names which reminded them of their inferior position in our society. The Savarna groups ascribed these levels only to prove that they were the superiors and the other were the inferiors. To reject all this, these jatis had decided to use the word Dalit as their own identity with pride. What Dalit literature is? Dalit literature is a literature that is written by Dalit about the lives of the Dalits. By the narratives like poems, short stories and autobiographies, harsh reality and political scene of the Dalit were portrayed in stark manner. The word Dalit can be seen as the thought and theoretical principle on which the entire Dalit literature rests. A short history of Dalit literature. Dalit literature bloomed in the year 1960s in the Marathi language, and later it appeared in other languages like Hindi, Bengali, Punjabi, etc. So the origin of Dalit can also be traced back to Buddhist literature. Buddha's thought were given development by some saint poet. Equality and logic, the most important two factors on which Buddhism lays emphasis, is what Dalit literature has foregrounded. Later in modern time, the doors of education and knowledge were opened for the Jatis after the British arrival, and they became aware of their ancient history of oppression and felt inferior. This enlightenment of education and knowledge made possible for the thinkers such as Jyotiba Phule, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, to emerge and to make progress in their movement of having equality. Ideology of Dalit literature. Opposition to Varna system, class, caste, gender discrimination, opposition to tradition, aesthetics and ritualism, support to freedom and equality to live as a human being in a Varnaless, classless and casteless society, support to no margins between people and support to liberty and independence. Now we will come to Sharatchandra Chattopadhyay, who was one of the famous Bengali novelist and short story writer of early 20th century. The lifestyle of the poor village people and their tragedy of struggling to survive in the society used to get highlighted in his works. The contemporary social practices of Bengal had also been focused by him. Still, he was not considered as a Dalit writer. He, in fact, was not a Dalit writer by birth, but the lifestyle of those poor people used to get highlighted in most of his works. Mahesh is one of his famous short story, and the plot of the story is well known to us, that the story is about a poor Muslim peasant Ghafur and his daughter Amina and their only bull Mahesh, on whom the name of the story is tattooed. The story speaks not only about Mahesh but also about humiliation, oppression and exploitation over the lower caste people by upper class. The extreme poverty and hunger of Ghafur's family were not destined but created by the upper class, and who were responsible for what happened to that family just remained in hope to be punished one day by Allah. So now we will consider or discuss about Mahesh as a Dalit writing, or how far it can be regarded as a Dalit writing. In Mahesh, Ghafur, a Muslim, challenges the caste Hindus' behavior towards non-Hindus and suffers the position of a Dalit who finally registers a passive resistance through dislocation. The lower castes of India for centuries have been oppressed by the Brahminical ideology and power. In Mahesh, the character of the Brahmin Tarka Ratna proved this harsh reality throughout the story by his behavior and attitudes towards the Muslim family of Ghafur. Even the animal, who did not have any caste, had been humiliated by the Brahmin Tarka Ratna only because he was the bull of a poor Muslim family. The contemporary situation of that poor people of the village as well as Bengal was highlighted by Sharatchandra. And not only poor people, but they can certainly be called Dalit who were oppressed, exploited and marginalized, as they were Muslim and they had no money and they were very poor and they had no power. Throughout the story, the main three characters have been humiliated by Brahmin, Zamindar and other powerful higher class people who were economically strong too. They had lot of money, but they was not used to help the poor but to humiliate them. Even Amina could not even had the right to get water from the pond owned by the zamindar of the village Kashipur, as she belonged to a Muslim family. The Muslim family also passed days without a single grain of rice and a single drop of water, and one day by such an incident, Ghafur lost his mind, and what he did at that moment also proved the situation of women in our society, that they were doubly, they were, they are, and they will be doubly marginalized, Dalit, outside as well as inside. Amina was blamed by his father that moment for not taking care of everything in the house and his father humiliated her by saying muk pora haramjada me shara din tui korish ki eto loke more tui morish ne disgraceful wretch girl what do you do the whole day so many people die why don't you die however gofu realized his mistakes later So by discussing these points, we can come to a conclusion that Sharadchandra Chattopadhyay was not a writer who was a Dalit by birth, and he was well known as a 20th century writer, not as Dalit writer. His short story Mahesh has some qualities and some points which make the reader to accept the story as a Dalit writing to some extent, but it cannot be called a Dalit writing completely. Firstly, the story was written before the Dalit movement was started. Secondly, the writer was not a Dalit by birth, and finally, the story doesn't focus on all the natures of a Dalit literature. So Mahesh obviously has some space of Dalit in it, but it cannot be considered as a complete Dalit writing. Thank you.
Okay, very good presentation by Konika Nath.
Thank you,
on
sir.
On the short story of Sharadchandra Chattopadhyay, Mahesh, which is a unique story in Bengali
yes,
literature,
yes,
because
sir.
Of its content.
Yes.
And characters of the story, Gafur, Amina. So it's an excellent and obviously it's a pathetic story.
Yes.
About the cow.
Mm.
And how he prayed.
Yes.
And the love to God.
Yes.
To give punishment. For,
yes.
Who are responsible for the death of the cow.
Yes.
So, Tonima, it's a very excellent presentation. Our next presenter is
Thank
Tonima
you,
Vishas.
Sir.
Thank you, Tonima.
Thank
Tanmay
you,
present with us. Okay, it's now over to Sujoy and Sumita Dutta. Carry forward the session.
Okay, so since Tanmay Vishwas is not with us,
okay,
our next participant would be Urmi Acharya.
Okay.
Urmi Acharya is a first semester English PG English student of Rishi Bankimchandra College, and her topic for discussion today is Article 15. A horrifying, honest portrayal of Indian caste
yes.
system. Urmi, now you may proceed with your presentation.
Yes, I am present. Let me. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sir, am I audible? Sir, am
yes,
I
you
audible?
Are audible. Please start your presentation. Yes, you are audible.
Sir, am I audible? Hello.
You are
yes,
audible.
Am I audible?
Start your presentation.
You start your paper, okay?
Yes. Let me present. Let me present my skin.
Okay. Okay.
Good evening to the respected chairs and other participants. The title of my paper is Article 15, a horrifyingly true portrayal of Indian caste system. In India, people of different race, religion, ethnicity have always lived together. The subcontinent is a diverse amalgamation of uniqueness. The caste system is a crucial aspect of Hindu religion, and people used to live by this institution in the past. One might think that the present India is free from all orthodox practices, but if the privileged people seldom venture out from their bubbles, they will be presented with ample evidence of still existing. Article 15 is a 2019 movie directed by Anubhav Sinha. It deals with lower caste or Dalits and the violence they go through for being born with a certain title and in a particular family. A form of art and any kind of art reflects society. So there is no doubt through this movie, the director holds a mirror of Indian caste system. The movie is shot by Ivan Mulligan. At a glance, it gives the viewers a sense of dread and foreboding. From the dingy house to the grey rain that marks the beginning of the film, all combined to create the dreary atmosphere. Article 15 was praised with positive reviews. The story unfolds, maintains the interest of the viewer throughout the movie. the plot. The plot of the movie follows Ayan Ranjan. He is appointed as the additional superintendent officer. Along his way, he asks the driver to stop the car in front of a shop and tells him to buy a water bottle. The driver replies that it is not allowed since the owners of the shop are lower caste and they should not even touch their shadow. This is how he is introduced to his first caste-related discrimination. He studied at St. Stephen's College in Delhi and later he went abroad. The reason this young IPS officer is posted in Lalgaon was his unprofessional reply to his superior. The reply was actually a cool sir in response to a serious question by his senior officer. By his reply, the officer thought he did not sound professional. It is in the village, the people are very careful about caste and they take it very seriously. It is ingrained in their whole mentality. In the party, in the welcome party, the water is given to Ayan, but it is covered with iron foil. When he reaches for some food from Jatap's plate, he stops saying that a new plate will be bought for him. He should not eat from the plate of a lower caste. Ayan notices some men and a woman outside the gate loitering about. He asks Brahmadat, his associate officer, about them, but he dismisses the topic by calling them a nuisance. In the party, Ayan notices his old college friend Satyendra Rai, but when he goes to talk with Satyendra, he acts restless in front of Ayan and avoids him. Later, though, it is Ayan who drives Satyendra to his home and meets with his pregnant wife. The next day, body of two girls are discovered hanging from a tree. Ayan becomes extremely disturbed at this occurrence. He calls his girlfriend Aditi, who works as a human rights activist. She tells Ayan that it is very different from what he is used to, and incidents like this occur throughout India. Brahmada says that the girls were homosexual, so the enraged fathers murdered them and orders to do the postmortem of the girls. On his way back from field, he meets Gowda. She is the elder sister of one of the missing girls. Her sister Pooja is still missing and tells Gowda to visit him at his place. There, Gowda relates to him the whole story before the disappearance of the girls. They worked in Anshu Naharia's factory for 25 rupees a day. The girls only demanded a mere raise of only 3 rupees in their salary, and for that they were slapped. The police are very reluctant to take the FIR, especially Brahmadat, who is insisting the incident as honor killing. Ayan becomes determined to find missing girls and solve the case, and orders to bring the postmortem. Brahmadat visits Dr. Malti, who was performing the test. She tells Malti to alter the earlier reports to make it look like a case of honor killing. In all this, Satyendra goes missing. Throughout all this, Ayan's interactions with his girlfriend Aditi helps him to maintain a level head. Sensing something is amiss, Ayan visits the hospital himself. There, Dr. Malti reveals to him that the girls are actually gang-raped for several days. Ayan instructs her to go to Lucknow for testing of DNA samples and contact him only. Presently, the jeep where Jatap and Mayank was set in fire by a band of Dalit revolutionaries. The name of their leader is Nishad. He is a knowledgeable person. By further investigation, Ayan about a suspicious yellow bus from a boy. A similar bus is spotted in front of his school, which belongs to Naharia. Upon searching the rooms, he discovers ample evidence of the girls being there. Meanwhile, Dr. Malti confirms that the DNA samples matched with Anshu Naharia's DNA. And summons Naharia and interrogates him. He confesses about slapping the girls upon the forest. He suspects that the missing girl is probably dead. But such needs and for available evidence of protest of Dalit workers. Ayan meets up with Nishad, and upon talking, Nishad agrees to help him. Some of the main details water he is drinking is cost more money than what those girls had demanded. He tracks He tracked the location of Satinda, who reveals that the party in that at the party at Onshu Nahariya's house, the girls were raped by Nahariya. Nihal Singh and Brahma that Nihal Singh commits suicide in front of his speeding truck because he was unable to bear the guilt of his deed. And with other members at last caused the quagmire in the forest, Pooja is discovered inside a pipe. The ending is symbolic, being tied to buys food from a roadside eatery. But when he asks the cast of the woman selling the food, her reply remains unheard. And with other officers burst into laughing. And this is how the movie ends. The movie is filled with nuances and symbolism. The opening song led by a Dalit woman, Gaura. In the opening of the movie, Gaura sings a song. It is a song about caste disparity between higher and lower caste. The higher caste people get better food, education, and place to stay. In contrast, the Dalits are pushed to the margin. Due to this discrepancy, caste movie. Song. It can be a symbol of hope, because the songs like talk about questions and properly answers them. The statue of B.R. Ambedkar on the pedestal looking over to the community and its issues is ironical. Ambedkar devoted his whole life to give equal rights to all the lower caste. The people in the village have his statue, but the moral values are lost. The name of the movie is Article 15. Ayan prints out the article and to remind everyone the essence of their duty. The moment is accompanied by right music and makes the scene very powerful. The article prohibits anyone to restrict the rights of any citizen solely on the grounds of race, religion, gender, and place of birth. Probably one of the most memorable scene in the movie when a Dalit worker goes into a manhole filled with human excrete. He dives into the drain in order to clean it. He does not have any kind of protective gear with him. The man is bare-bodied. There is no dialogue here, but the scene shows him toiling and removing the filth. Like this, the Dalits go into the field to make a more habitable place for the society. Without their assistance, the society would tumble down. These people are like strong pillars who carry the weight on their backs, but they are also the ones who are getting crushed. The ending is also significant. When the old woman answered Ayan's question about her caste, the reply cannot be shared. It indicates that at last people are moving forward. They share the food cooked by her and laugh at the question. It is a sharp contrast to the first scene when Ayan is told not to buy water from a shop because of their caste. The people are now somewhat reformed now in their ways. Portrayal of society. The village society where the movie is set is stagnant. Here, the individual's caste determines their value in life. Sometimes, when someone like Jatak climbs up in the social ladder, in spite of belonging to a lower caste, he is still reminded of his low status by everyone. The Dalit workers are paid minimum wage and they are expected to work the maximum hours. Their status automatically makes them entitled to all of violence. This is what the upper caste think. They are expected to perform their jobs without question. The ones who do end up raped or murdered. When Ayan was questioning Nahariya his reasons for slapping the girls, the man's nonchalant reply was that the girls deserve it. It is unimaginable for him that people who dare to disobey his order, even after belonging to a lower caste. He did this to set an example to the whole village. If they ever think of rising against, then they will end up the same way. It is also the reason their bodies were hanged instead of disposing of them in other ways, so that everyone can witness the consequence of insubordination. To safeguard one's interest, these people do not even hesitate to kill their associates. Brahmadat kills Nahariya to destroy any evidence of his involvement. He wanted to secure his space as an innocent person, so it was important to discard any evidence. But strangely enough, Brahmadat is sympathetic towards animals. In more than once in the film, he is shown feeding dogs, or sometimes he is also taking them to the vets if they are sick. Though his reasons are unclear, whether he does this to redeem himself or out of natural love, it is not clearly shown. representation of women. We get two prominent female characters in the movie. One is Gowda. She is Dalit but has strong conviction of values and justice. She prompted other Dalits to lodge the FIR. She and Nishat are in a relationship and she firstly protests of Nishat's kidnapping. The other one is Anne's girlfriend, Aditi. She is educated, privileged, and a human rights activist. Aditi is very much focused on highlighting the atrocities of Dalits despite her status. She remarks to Anne that she does not need a hero, but she wants someone who will stop expecting the hero to do the right thing. Among the three kidnapped girls, Pooja seems to be the most resistant and has a strong will to survive. She is very brave. She is the one who dares to cross the marshlands to reach the other side, which proves beneficial to her survival. In general, the women are subjected and abused. They have no rights and live in constant fear. Revolution and corruption. In Article 15, corrupt ministers and police officers exist to exploit the system. After the incident, a political leader arrives to the affected families to console them. But Gowda tells that the minister does not eat from the utensils of the Dalits and he brings his own food. It is shown to the media that he is eating with this same plate with the Dalits, but this is all a facade. It is an attempt to back all the votes of the minorities. Yet people like Nishat are also present. He is leader of a Dalit group that protests against the injustices on his people. Later he is encountered, but his spirit is indomitable after his last breath. He justifies that after his death, thousands like him will come having the same mindset. Panikkar is a CBI officer who likes to mock and blackmail others for his advances. He deems Ayan unsuitable because of his inability to speak fluent Hindi and for his privileged background. Male like him help to tighten the hold of caste system. Echoes of real incidents. Article 15 is a work of fiction, but two major real life incidents are base of this movie. One is 2014 gang rape of two Dalit girls in Pudaun, Uttar Pradesh. The two Dalit girls are minors and cousins. They were kidnapped and gang raped. Their bodies were found hanging from a tree. The local police officers are involved in the incident. The United Nations condemned this incident and deemed the quick punishment of the offenders. The 2016 flogging incident where seven tanners were attacked and assaulted in accusation of killing a cow. More than 40 higher caste men attacked seven Dalit workers on the accusation of cow slaughtering. The Dalits belonged to Sabharia family and they were actually skinning the carcass of a dead cow. It is their profession. Four of them were stripped and tied to the back of the car where they were beaten with sticks, iron rods. Some of the offenders recorded the beating. Conclusion. Article 15 is a thought-provoking and does not shy away to show the gruesome reality of India. The dialogues are acute and powerful. In some sense, there are no dialogues, but the visuals impact the audience. It attempts to make the public aware of the conditions of Dalits still prevalent in India. The ending of the movie is hopeful, so it can be interpreted that Anubhav, the director, wants the viewers to understand that it is important to take active participation if these practices
Okay, thank you, Urmi Acharya, for your nice presentation. Okay, have you completed?
Yes, sir.
Okay, it was an excellent presentation by you. So you have watched the movie Article 15 by Ayushman Khurrana?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so in the movie, in one of the scenes, you can see that there was a senior officer who wades into the waste level mud in search of a missing girl, and he asks a constable if his mother had any advice for such dangerous works, dangerous victims.
Yes.
And to this, the man denies.
And he replies, "Daag achhe hai."
Daag achhe hai. So such kind of yes. TV ads. So such there was a kind of situational humor
the TV ads, where the advertisements also promote such kind of impatience or discrimination, such as by fearing lovely, isn't it?
Yes, so, sir. Yes, sir.
Very good presentation by you. So, Urmi Acharya was our last paper presenter, because our last paper presenter was Vinit Ranga, but unfortunately he is absent in this session. So we have out of 11 paper presenters, only 7 paper presenters presented their papers. And truly, I want to say one thing, that it was such an exciting and riveting session that I am really, really surprised by the presentations of some of our students from PG, MA PG semester. Because many students were there, and they have presented in such an unexpected manner that I am really surprised that how they have prepared, how they have rendered tremendous effort in preparing their papers, and the presentations were really, really excellent. So I am very much happy that they have utilized this this period of lockdown, and they have prepared their papers in a PPT format, in a Word format, and they have gone through the text in detail. So it's a very good sign about our students, and also excellent presentations by other paper presenters also. And it was really an enriching session, and it was really a excellent experience about the webinar on English literature from the margins of class, caste, race, and gender. The more we prepare such kind of webinars in such social networking sites or social networking platforms, Google Meet or Zoom or YouTube, the more such kind of topics can be taken to the forefront, and such topics can be mainstreamed. So this is an excellent effort by all of us. So we are now at the end of our session, because we don't have any other paper presenters here. And at the end, I want to thank especially Chandranath Adhikari sir, our associate professor, Shubhabrata Sarkar sir, without whom it would have been impossible to conduct such kind of webinars, because he told me that he also had a sleepless night for 1 week, how he has conducted the entire session, conducted the entire webinars that was started from 22nd of August on African literature. Because you all know, or you may not know, that in the last webinar on African literature, we had almost 2,500 registered participants, and we got huge response from all parts of India. And we advertised also in Facebook, in WhatsApp groups, in Telegram groups. And you know that that in our last international webinar on African literature, we have almost 230 plus paper presenters. And with the continuation with that, in our today's international webinar on English literature from the margins of class, caste, race, and gender, we have almost 700 plus registered participants. So this is our success. This is our joint success. And we have almost 130 plus paper presenters. And I again
want to convey my sincere thanks, sincere gratitude to our data coordinator, Professor Dr. Shubhabrata Sarkar, sir, who has worked hard to realize this webinar, and also to our honorable principal, sir, Professor Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Shah, sir, who has encouraged us and motivated us. And I also want to thank all my dear colleagues. And finally, I want to thank especially to one of my dear colleagues and one of my dear student, Sujoy Sen Gupta and Sumita Dotto, without whom
thank you, sir.
It would have been impossible for
thank
me
you,
to conduct the entire session, because I very frankly I want to confess one thing, that I am not so expert like you, like Sumita or like Sujoy, in technical expertises. I am not so expert, but you two guys have facilitated my work and it become easier for me. So I am really thankful to both of you, to Sujoy Sengupta and Sumita Dotto. You made my task really easier. Without you, it would have been impossible for me to run the entire session. Thank you so much. So now it's over to Sujoy and Sumita.
Thank you, sir. It's been an honor to participate in this webinar, and it's been also an honor to coordinate with you in chair and Sumita as co-coordinator. And now I'll hand over the baton to Sumita. Sumita, please go on.
Thank you, sir, and thank you, Professor
Sujoy Sengupta. Sorry to interrupt you. Please inform the participants about the e-certificate, the feedbacks, and the video links. Okay. Please inform all the participants.
Okay. Okay. So the all participants who registered, they will get their e-certificate SUML by SBSSAT. So now I'm going to sum up our session. So thank you everyone, and our honorable chairperson, Professor Tanvi Sahanawaz, sir. We had a great, wonderful kaleidoscopic presentation through this webinar. Cordially thanks to all for enlightening and motivating all of us. I would like to share the vote of thanks to all of them who have helped us in this webinar for making it successful. First of all, I would like to propose heartiest vote of thanks to our honorable principal, Dr. Sanjeev Shah of Rishi Bunkim Chandra College, and Dr. Devashish Bhoumik from Rishi Bunkim Chandra Building College. And again, I want to thank Professor Tanvi Sahanawaz, assistant professor of Rishi Bunkim Chandra College, and Professor Ruksha Roy Choudhury, faculty member of Rishi Bunkim Chandra College. I would like to thank all of the speakers for their presentations. All the scholars have made their excellent presentations and lead to the webinar to a great success. I do mention that without their active participation, we won't be able to conduct this session as well as this webinar. Again, I want to thank all of them and the organizing committee and the members, students, faculty members, and the paper presenters. And last but not the least, I would like to thank our honorable associate professor of Rishi Bunkim Chandra College, Dr. Shubhabrata Sarkar, for his tireless technical support and operation. So here we go to sum up our technical session number 11 of the second and last of international webinar on English literature from the margins of class, caste, race, and gender. So thank you, everybody.
So this is the end of session 11. Thank you.